أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذ قال إبراهيم رب اجعل هذا البلد رب إنهن أضللن كثيرا من الناس فمن تبعني فإنه مني ومن عصاني فإنك غفور رحيم ربنا فاجعل أفئدة من الناس تهوي إليهم وارزقهم من الثمرات لعلهم يشكرون رب ربنا إنك تعلم ما نخفي وما نعلن وما يخفى على الله من شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء الحمد لله الذي وهب لي على الكبر إسماعيل وإسحاق إن ربي لسميع رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل ربنا اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين الله العلي العظيم.
محمد وآل محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. لوگو در زہرا پہ قیامت کی گھڑی ہے, لوگو در زہرا پہ قیامت کی گھڑی ہے, آغاز کربلا ہے, مصیبت یہ بڑی ہے. تم عید کی خوشیوں میں کہیں بھول نہ جانا, تم عید کی خوشیوں میں کہیں بھول نہ جانا. بازار میں مسلم کی ابھی لاش پڑی ہے, لوگو در زہرا دل زہرا پہ. کی زوجہ مسلم نے یہ فغاں ہے میرے دونوں لال کہاں, کی زوجہ مسلم نے یہ فغاں ہے میرے دونوں لال کہاں, ساتھ جو میرے دو دلبر وہ فدیہ کیے میں نے حق پر, جو ساتھ تمہارے تھے ہیں کہاں, ہیں میرے دونوں لال کہاں. میں بستی بستی جاؤں گی اور ڈھونڈ کے ان کو لاؤں گی, بتلائیے کچھ تو ان کا نشان ہے میرے دونوں لال کہاں. کب تک وہ رہے زیر سایہ اور کس کو ترس ان پر آیا, کس گھر میں ہے اب تک وہ مہمان, ہے میرے دونوں لال کہاں. بس اتنا بتا دیجئے والی دنیا تو نہیں ان سے خالی, کیا مل گئی ان کو جائے اماں, ہیں دونوں میرے ہیں میرے دونوں لال کہاں. لاشِ مسلم نے یہ صدا, دے صبر کی طاقت تجھ کو خدا, ہو جائے گا تجھ پر جلد عیاں, ہیں میرے دونوں لال کہاں. کوفے میں انی سے اہل حرام تھے, نالکنا وقت ماتام, سن کر یہ صدا محشر تھا آیا, ہیں میرے دونوں لال کہاں. محمد و آل محمد صلی اللہ علیہ
وسلم. صلوا علی محمد و آل محمد.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم إني أسألك برحمتك التي وسعت كل شيء وبقوتك التي كهرت بها كل شيء وخضع لها كل شيء وذل لها كل شيء وبجبروتك التي غلبت بها كل شيء وبعزتك التي لا يقوم لها شيء وبعظمتك التي ملأت كل شيء وبسلطانك الذي على كل شيء وبوجهك الباقي بعد فناء كل شيء وبأسمائك التي ملأت أركان كل شيء وبعلمك الذي أحاط بكل شيء وبنور وجهك الذي أضاء له كل شيء يا نور يا قدوس يا أول الأولين ويا آخر الآخرين اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تحت كل اسم اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تنزل النقم اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تغير النعم اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تحبس الدعاء اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تكتب الرجاء اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تنزل البلاء اللهم اغفر لي كل ذنب أذنبته وكل خطيئة أخطأتها اللهم إني أتقرب إليك بذكرك وأستشبه بك إلى نفسك وأسألك بجودك أن تدنيني من قربك وأن توزعني شكرك وأن تلهمني ذكرك اللهم إني أسألك سؤال خاضع متذلل خاشع أن تسامعني وترحمني وتجعلني بقسمك راضيا كانيا وفي جميع الأحوال متواضيا اللهم وأسألك السؤال من اشتدت فاقته وأنزل بك عند الشدائد حاجته وعظم فيما عندك رغبته اللهم عظم سلطانك ولا مكانك وخفي مكرك وظهر أمرك وغلب كهرك وجرت قدرتك ولا يمكن الفرار من حكومتك اللهم لا أجد لذنوبي غافرا ولا لكبائي ساترا ولا لشيء من عملي الكبيه بالحسن مبدلا غيرك لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك وبحمدك ظلمت نفسي وتجرأت بجهلي وسكنت إلى قديم ذكرك لي ومنك علي اللهم مولاي كم من كبير سترت وكم من فاض من البلاء أكلت وكم من إثار وكيت وكم من مكروه دفعت وكم من ثناء جميل لست أهلا لو نشرت اللهم أضم بلائي وأفرت بي سوء حالي وكسرت بي أعمالي وكادت بي أغلالي وحبسني النفب ذو عملي وخذتني الدنيا بغرورها ونفسي بجنايتها بيوم التالي يا سيدي فأسألك بعزتك أن لا يحجب عنك دعائي سوء عملي وفعالي ولا تفزعني بخفي ما اطلعت عليه من سري ولا تؤجلني بالعقوبة على ما عملته في خلواتي من سوء فعلي وإساءتي ودوام تفريتي وجحالتي وكثرة شهواتي وغفلتي وكن اللهم بعزتك لي في كل الأحوال رؤوفا وعلي في جميع الأمور أتوفى إلهي وربي من لي غيرك أسأله كشف الضر والنظر في أمري إلهي ومولاي أجريت علي حكما اتبعت فيه هوى نفسي ولم أحترس فيه من تزيين عدوي فغرني بما أهوى وأسد ولا ذلك القضاء فتجاوزت بما جرى علي من ذلك بعد حدودك وخالفت بعض أوامرك فلك الحمد علي في جميع ذلك ولا حجة لي فيما جرى علي في قضاءك والزمني حكمك بلاؤه وقد أتيتك يا إلهي بعد تقصيري وإسرافي على نفسي معتذرا نادما منكسرا مستكيلا مستغفرا مريبا مقيلا مذعنا معترفا لا أجد مفرا مما كان مني ولا موذن أتوجه إليه في أمري غير قبولك عذري وإدخالك إياي في سعة من رحمتك اللهم فاقبل عذري وارحم شدة ضري وفكني من شد وثاكي يا ربي ارحم ضعف بدني وركة جلدي ودقة عظمي يا من بدا خلقي وذكري وتربيتي وبري وتغذيتي ابني لابتداء كرمك والسالف برك بي يا إلهي والسيدي وربي أتراك معظمي بنارك بعد توحيدك وبعد من تبع عليه قلبي من معرفتك وليج باللسان من ذكرك واعتقد ضميري من حبك وبعد صدق اعترافي ودعائي خاضيا لربوبيتي حياتا تكرم من ان تزيا من ربيت او تبيد من ادنيت او تشرد من عاويت او تسلم الى البلاء من كفيت ورحمت وليت شعري يا سيدي والهي ومولاي تسلط النار على وجوه خرت لعظمتك الساجدا وعلى السن نتكت بتوحيدك الصادق وبشكرك معدها وعلى قلوب اعترفت بإلهيتك محققا وعلى ضمائر حوت من العلم بك حتى صارت خاشعة وعلى جوارح ساتي الأوطان تعبدك الطائية وأشارت باستغفارك مضعنة ما كذا الظن بك ولا أقبلنا بفضلك أنك يا كريم يا ربي وأنت تعلم ضعفي عن قليل من بلاء الدنيا وعقوباتها وما يجري فيها من المكاره على أهلها ألا أن ذلك بلاء ومكروه قليل مكثوه يسير بقاؤه كثير مدته فكيف احتمال البلاء إلى آخر وجليل وقوع المكاره فيها وهو بلاء تطول مدته ويدوم مقامه ولا يخفف عن أهله لأنه لا يكون إلا عن غضبك وانتقامك وسخطك وهذا ما لا تقوم له السماوات والأرض يا سيدي فكيف لي وأنا عبدك الضعيف الذليل الحقير المسكين المستكين يا إلهي وربي وسيدي ومولاي لأي الأمور إليك أشكو ولما من أضج وأبكي لأليم العذاب وشدتي أم لطول البلاء ومدتي فلئن سيرتني للعقوبات مع أعدائك وجمعت بيني وبين أهل بلائك وفرقت بيني وبين أحبائك وأوليائك فابني يا إلهي وسيدي ومولاي وربي صبرت على عذابي فكيف أصبر على فراقك وحبني صبرت على حر نارك فكيف أصبر عن النظر إلى كرامتك أم كيف أسكن في النار ورجائي عفوك فبعزتك يا سيدي ومولاي أقسم صادقا لئن تركتني نعوتك لأضيجن إليك بين أهل الضجيج العاملين ولا أصرخن إليك صراخ المستصرخين ولا أبكين عليك بكاء الفاقدين ولو نادينك إن كنت يا ولي المؤمنين يا غاية أعمال العارفين يا غياث المستغيثين يا حبيب قلوب الصادقين ويا إله العالمين أفتراك سبحانك يا إلهي وبحمدك تسمع فيها صوت عبد مسلم سجن فيها بمخالفتي وذاك طعم عذابها بمعصيتي وأوبس بين أطباقها بجرمه وجريرتي وهو يزج إليك ضجيج معمل لرحمتك ويناديك بلسان أهل توحيدك ويتوسل إليك بربوبيتك يا مولاي، فكيف يبقى في العذاب وهو يرجو ما سلف من علمك ورعفتك؟ أم كيف تولم النار وهو يأمل فضلك ورحمتك؟ أم كيف يهلك لهيبها وأنت تسمع صوته وترى مكانه؟ أم كيف يشتمل عليه زفيرها وأنت تعلم ضعفا؟ أم كيف يتكلكل بين أتباعك وأنت تعلم صدقا؟ أم كيف تزجر زبانيتها وهو يناديك يا ربه؟ أم كيف يرجو فضلك في إتك منها فتتركه فيها؟ هيهات، ما ذلك الظن بك؟ ولا المعروف من فضلك ولا مشبه لما عملت بالموحدين من برك وإحسانك، فباليقين أكتو لولا ما أكمت بي من تعظيم جاهدك وقضيت بي من إخلاد معاندك لجعلت النار كلها بردا وسلاما، وما كان لأحد فيها مقرا ولا مقاما، لكنك تقدست أسماؤك أقسمت أن تملأها من الكافرين من الجنة والناس أجمعين، وأن تخلد فيها المعاندين، وأن تجلى ثناؤك قلت مبتديا وتتولت بالإنعام متكرما، فمن كان مؤمنا كمن كان فاسقا لا يستوون. إلهي وسيدي، فأسألك بالقدرة التي قدرتها وبالقضية التي أتمتها وأكمتها وغلبت من علي أجريتها، أن تحب لي في هذه الليلة وفي هذه الساعة كل جرم أجرمته وكل ذنب أذنبته وكل كبير أسررته وكل جهل عملته، كتمته وأعلنته، أكفيته وأظهرته، وكل سيئة أمرت بإثبات الكرام الكاتبين الذين وكلتهم بيبدي ما يكون مني، وجعلتهم شهودا علي مع جواره، وكنت أنت الرقيب علي من ورائهم والشاهد لما خفي عنهم، وبرحمتك أكفيت وبفضلك سترت، وأن توفر عدي من كل خير أنزلت أو إحسان فضلت أو بر نشرت أو رزق بسطت أو ذنب تغفر أو خطأ تستر، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، يا إلهي وسيدي ومولاي ومالك رقي، يا من بيدي ناسي، يا عليما بضري ومسكنتي، يا خبيرا بفقري وفاقتي، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، أسألك بحقك وقدسك وعظم صفاتك وأسماعك أن تجعل أوقاتي من الليل والنهار بذكرك معمورا وبخدمتك موصولة وأعمالي عندك مقبولة، حتى تكون أعمالي وأورادي وإرادتي كلها وردا واحدا وحالي في خدمتك السرمدا، يا سيدي يا من علي مولي، يا من إليه شكوت أحوالي، يا ربي يا ربي يا رب، قوي على خدمتك جواري واسدد على العزيمة جوانه، وحبلي الجد في خشيتك والدوام في الاتصال بخدمتك، حتى أسرع إليك في ميادين السابقين وأسري إليك في البارزين، وأشتاق إلى قربك في المشتاقين وأدنو منك دنو المخلصين، وأخافك مخافة الموقنين والتمي في جوارك مع المؤمنين. اللهم ومن أرادني بسوء فأعرض، ومن كادني فكد، واجعلني من أحسن عبيدك نصيبا عندك وأقربهم منزلة منك وأخصهم زلفة لديك، فإنه لا ينال ذلك إلا بفضلك، وجدلي بجودك وأعطف علي بمدك واحفظني برحمتك، وجل لساني بذكرك الحجة وقلبي بحبك متيما ومن لي بحسن إجابتك وأقل لي أصلتي وأكفر زلتي فإنك قضيت على عبادك بعبادتك وأمرتهم بدعائك وزمنت لهم الإجابة فإليك يا ربي نسبت وجهي وإليك يا ربي مددت يدي فبعزتك استجب لي دعائي وبلغني مناي ولا تقطع من فضلك رجائي واكفني شر الجن والإنس من أعدائي يا رضا اكفر لمن لا يملك إلا الدعاء فإنك فعال لما تشاء يا من اسمه دواء وذكره شفاء وتعطه غنى ارحم من راس ماله الرجاء وسلاه البكاء يا سابق النعم يا دافي النقم يا نور المستوحشين في الظلام يا عالم لا يعلم صل على محمد وآل محمد وافعل بي ما انت اهله وصلى الله على رسوله والائمه الميامين من اله وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا اللهم صل على رحم الله من كرع سوره مباركه الفاتحه
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر ولله الحمد الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين عليا ولي الله الله سلامه عليك أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين عليا حجة الله صلوات الله السلام حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح حي على خير الأمل هيا على خير الأمل الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أشهد أن محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أشهد أن علي ولي الله أشهد أن عليا حجة الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح حي على خير العمل حي على خير العمل قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله صلاتي ونسقي ومحياي ومماتي لله رب العالمين وجهت وجه الذي فطر السماوات والأرض حنيفا مسلما الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين
اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواسوا بالحق وتواسوا بالصبر. الله أكبر. سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي العلى وبحمده. الله أكبر. أستغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه. الله أكبر. سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي العلى وبحمده. الله أكبر. بحول الله وقوته أقوم وأقعد وأرقى وأسجد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. كذلك الله ربي. الله أكبر. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. الله أكبر. سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمده. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده. الله أكبر. استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه. الله أكبر. سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده. الله أكبر. الحمد لله وخير الأسماء لله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بحول الله وقوته أقوم وأقعد وأرقى وأسجد. الله أكبر. سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد. الله أكبر. استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه. الله أكبر. سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد. يا لطيف ارحم عبدك الضعيف. الله أكبر. الحمد لله وخير الأسماء لله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما.
الله صل على محمد وآل محمد. الله صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل.
استغفر الله الذي لا اله الا هو الحي القيوم ذو الجلال والاكرام واتوب اليه. استغفر الله الذي لا اله الا هو الحي القيوم ذو الجلال والاكرام واتوب اليه. استغفر الله الذي لا اله الا هو الحي القيوم ذو الجلال والاكرام واتوب اليه. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم اني اسالك موجبات رحمتك وعزائم مغفرتك والنجاة من النار ومن كل بلية والفوز بالجنة والرضوان في دار السلام. وجوار نبيك محمد عليه وآله السلام. اللهم ما بنا من نعمة فمنك. لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.
اللهم صل على محمد.
نماز هدي ميت is requested for مرحومه منيره باي wife of مرحوم محمد اتش ام ناصر and daughter of مرحوم محمد حسين شريف ديوجي.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن عليا ولي الله أشهد أن عليا حجة الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح حي على خير العمل حي على خير العمل قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله صلاة العشاء إن الصلاة ونسقي ومحياي ومماتي لله رب العالمين إني وجهت وجهي الذي فطر السماوات حنيفا الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواسوا بالحق وتواسوا بالصبر الله أكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمده سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده الله أكبر استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده الله أكبر بحول الله وقوته أقوم وأقعد وأرقى وأسجد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد كذلك الله ربي الله أكبر اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد الله أكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمده سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر
سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده
الله أكبر استغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر
سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده
الله أكبر الحمد لله وخير الأسماء لله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد بحول الله وقوته أقوم وأقعد وأرقى وأسجد الله أكبر سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمده سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر
سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان الله سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده
Allahu Akbar. Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa atubu ilayh. Allahu Akbar.
Subhanallah, 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 subhana rabbiyal a'la wa bihamdih.
Allahu Akbar. Bihawlillahi wa quwwatihi aqumu wa aqa'ad wa arqa wa asjad. Allahu Akbar.
Subhanallah, 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 subhana rabbiyal azim wa bihamdi rabbi salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Sami'allahu liman hamida. Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah, 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 subhana rabbiyal ala wa bihamdi rabbi salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad.
Allahu Akbar. Astaghfirullah rabbi wa atubu ilayh. Allahu Akbar.
Subhanallah, 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 subhana rabbiyal a'la wa bihamdi rabbi salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad ya latif irham abdaka al-da'if.
Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillah wa khairul asma'i lillah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabiy wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi s-salihin. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما.
أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليه. أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليه. أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليه. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم إنه ليس لي بموضع رزقي وإنما أطلبه بكثرات تكثر على كلبي فأجل في طلبه البلدان فأنا فيما أنا طالبك الحيران لا أدري في سهل هو أم في جبل أم في أرض أم في سماء أم في بر أم في بر ولا يدي من ومن قبل من وقد علمت أن علمه عندك وأسبابه بيدك وأنت الذي تقسمه بلطفك وتسببه برحمتك. اللهم فصل على محمد واله واجعل يا ربي رزقك لي واسعا ومقلبه سهلا ومأخذه قريبا ولا تؤنني بطلب ما لم تقدر لي فيه رزقا فإنك غني عن عذابي وأنا فقير إلى رحمتك فصل على محمد وآله وجز على عبدك بفضلك إنك ذو فضل عظيم.
Salaam alaikum Abu Abdullah, Salaam alaikum Ibn Rasulullah, Salaam alaikum Ibn Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Ibn Sayyid al-Wasiyyin, Assalamu alaikum Ibn Fatimah al-Zahra, Sayyidat al-Nisa al-Alameen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Assalamu alaikum Mawla Ibn Mawla, Assalamu alaikum Ya Ghareeb al-Ghuraba, Assalamu alaikum Sultan Abul Hasan, Ali Ibn Musa al-Raza, Rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Assalamu alaikum Sahib al-Zaman, Assalamu alaikum Khalifat al-Rahman, السلام علیکم شریک القرآن السلام علیکم کعبۃ الایمان السلام علیکم یا اہل بیت نبوہ جمیعا ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ اللهم کن لولیک الحجۃ ابن الحسن صلواتک علیہ وعلی آبائی فی هذه الساعۃ وفی کل ساعۃ ولیا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سيد شبير كرماني respected elders brothers and sisters السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Sir Fatah has requested for the Salah Sawab of the Marhumin listed on the screen and for all Marhumin Al-Fatiha Amin Yajibu is requested for the names listed on the screen and for all those in need here and elsewhere. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ يَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ 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 أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ يَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ. Weekend Islamic School. Enrollment for the upcoming madrasa year at Masjid Hayy is now open. Classes are available for children pre-K to grade 12. Deadline to register is July 31st, and more details about the open house will be shared in the coming weeks. At this time, I'd like to invite Sayyid Shabbir to recite tonight's madras with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
إن الله بصير بالعباد ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل ونعم المولى ونعم النصير والصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على الرسول المسدد المصطفى الأمجد المحمود الأحمد الذي سمي في السماء بأحمد وفي الأرض بأبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى أهل بيت الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على وقل رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي أما بعد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتاب الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولئن شكرتم لأزيدنكم صدق الله العلي العظيم زينوا مجالسكم بالصلوات على محمد وآل محمد السلام My respected elders, brothers and sisters in Iman and youngsters here in Florida, across the globe, wherever you're hearing my voice, Salamun alaikum jamian wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Question, how do you raise righteous children? When coming to commemorate the children from the Ahlul Bayt, especially in tonight's night where we're commemorating the children of Muslim Ibn Aqil, that is, the Flani Muslim, one moment for us to reflect on is how do we raise righteous children in our own times, in our own world? Children like the likes of Muhammad and Ibrahim, the likes of the Flani Muslim. How can we raise children the likes of Aliun al-Akbar, the likes of Qasim, the likes of Aun and Muhammad, and likes of those children or those young adults who are there in Karbala, especially with Muharram around the corner. How can we do this? Now, keep in mind that although these individuals that I've just mentioned were at a very high position and a very high status, they were not necessarily ma'soom, or at least they were not at, there's ismat, that is ma'soomiyat, that is infallibility of the minor nature and the major nature. At least they were not at the major ismat, that is major ma'soom. They may have been minor ma'soom. For example, when the scholars discuss Lady Zainab, salamullahi alayha, Bibi Zainab, they say although she was not at the level of ismat kubra, that is that ismat which is major that the 14 ma'soomin have, for example, but she was at another level of ismat, which was a minor ismat. Similarly, how is it that we can learn from these individuals' lives and implement those teachings in our lives in order to raise righteous children? Therefore, without drawing too long of an introduction, I will jump straight in, respecting your time and my own. The first element of what we'll try to look at, number one, is what is the tradition and the precedent of raising righteous children within the Islamic faith? And we'll look at the various prophets and the emissaries and the representatives of God. That is, did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's representatives, they raised children, were all of their children righteous? Or not necessarily righteous? Whose children are righteous? Whose children were not righteous? Once we look at this, the next level will be then, well, if the children are righteous or not righteous, who's responsible for that righteousness or lack thereof? The third thing that we'll look at, what does some of the modern science say with respect to how one should raise children? How should one actually interact with their children? What should that conversation and that dialogue be like? Where has the paradigm come to? And what are the psychologists, the scientists, the psychiatrists, what are they saying with respect to how one should communicate with their children? And the fourth level of what we'll look at tonight is the lives, briefly, of these two individuals who we are here to commemorate. That is the children of Muslim ibn Aqil. Were these the only children? Were there more children? And what lessons do we get from these children and ultimately all of the children of Karbala? This is our agenda for tonight. Wherever you are, here in Florida or across the globe, from the bottom of your heart, send a salawat on Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. At the first level, when it comes to raising righteous children, oftentimes there are these things that perpetuate in our communities, which are sometimes well-intended or well-intentioned, but oftentimes they're just things that are repeated and they don't necessarily mean that are reality. I'll give you an example. The world has come very forward and it's come very far from where we were maybe 100 years ago or 200 years ago in certain things. In others, there are other things to be desired. But oftentimes in our communities, especially when we look at the family structure, who's responsible for raising righteous children? Is it the mom? Is it the dad? Is it a combination? Is it a whole village? Because there used to be that old saying that it takes a whole village to raise a child. Well, where's our village today? That's a question that we need to ask. Although we may be living in crowds, are these crowds communities? That's a separate question for another conversation for another day. You may find that we need to have a forum on this. I'm talking nationally and globally. You may find that our communities are not communities at all. You may find that they are just crowds of people that are sitting together. Because we may not know what's going on in someone else's life. We have no idea what's going on in their life. Recessions come, recessions go. We have no idea who's suffering. Depressions come, depressions go. We have no idea. So if you really go to the root of it, you may find we're not actually communities at all. We're just crowds of people sitting next to one another, in proximity of one another. We have not truly understood what a community is in the truest sense of the word. When you do a bypass, when you do an operation, you open up the chest and you find out what is the damage inside, this is perhaps when you peel back the layers of the onion, this is perhaps what you will find. I'll give you an example. There was this concept in the past, which was perhaps good, of this concept of a guest coming to your house. Now we try to avoid guests like the plague, perhaps. Sometimes in the past, guests used to come uninvited. You just have a room ready for them that they'll come at any point in time. And this is how communities were built. We had this sense of fraternity, this sense of brotherhood or sisterhood that was there. We may be missing these things. Similarly, when it comes to this, oftentimes we say, who's responsible? One thing that's very common in our communities is that we say, for example, oh, it's the mother. The mother should be the one. The mother is responsible. Make sure you pick the right mother. Although there's a lot of evidence and proof from the traditions of the Ahlul Bayt about that. For example, Imam Ali looking after and telling his brother to make sure that he's able to find Aqil, the father of Muslim, to find the right spouse for him. For example, he says, find for me a courageous woman. Does he not know? He knows. But he's giving a principle that these things do matter. But they're necessary, but not necessarily sufficient. Because there's a problem. Why? When we say it's all the mother, first of all, that puts a lot of pressure on the mom, number one, especially in our modern world, number one. Number two, Islamically, a lot of the responsibility actually falls on the father in terms of looking after and the responsibilities of caretaking for the child. So how do you reconcile that? So we need to look at this and explore this a little further. The next level, let's come to the lives of the prophets, the emissaries, those representatives of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Starting with the first and going to the last, with Adam to Khatam. When you come to Adam alayhi salam, how were Adam's children? Isn't Adam known as Adam alayhi salam, Prophet Adam, known as the father of man? He's the one who's leading this whole charge of humanity. The father of mankind is Adam alayhi salam. When we come to the life of Adam alayhi salam, he has a son by the name of Habil. But this Habil, is it the only son? No. You will find within that, you will also find Qabil. And you will find within the Bible this idea of Cain and Abel. These are two brothers, one being the good one, and the other one, perhaps not the good one. And from the Islamic tradition, similarly, you'll find Habil and Qabil. Habil or Abel being the one who is good, and then Qabil or Cain being the one who's not good. Two siblings, two sons from the same father. One good, one not so good. So can you blame Adam alayhi salam or Bibi Hawa? For you raised one child who was great, you raised another one who was not so great? That means this requires a little bit more analysis, because a prophet can give rise to a child who is not necessarily the best. First example. Second example, Nuh alayhi salam. The ark of Nuh, that is the flood is coming. The flood is coming and water is seeping over all of the earth, and the ark is raising higher and higher, and the son of Nuh, Nuh is on the ark. Noah is on the ark, and Nuh is there, and his son has come to a mountain or a hill. He's come to a height. And he's saying to his son, Noah is saying to his biological son, come onto the ark, come onto the ship. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to him, what? Innahu laysa min ahli, innahu amalun ghayru salih. Allah says to Noah, he says, this one is not from you. Whoa, ya Allah, you are telling Noah that his son is not his son. That means the definition of son in Allah's dictionary and Allah's vocabulary and Allah's vernacular is different than ours. Although Nuh wanted his son to come onto the ship, he did not get that right. He did amalun ghayru salih. He did actions which were not good. So that asks the question, was the tarbiyah of the Prophet inadequate, insufficient? It's a question. We'll answer that in a moment. Further than this, come to Ibrahim alayhi salam. You come to Ibrahim's life and you find that Ibrahim is that individual who's giving rise to the likes of Ismail, or from the Bible, Ishaq. There's a difference on who it was. Was it Isaac or was it Ishmael? From our view, it's Ishmael. Anyways, the principle is the same. When you come to the Islamic version of this narrative, you will find the same thing. The father and son were completely aligned. Ibrahim, the test, which we call the test of Ibrahim, according to the ulama, is not only the test of Ibrahim, it is also the test of Ismail. Now, I've told you numerous times, I mentioned this in Eid al-Hadha and other times as well, the test of Ibrahim is not your test and my test. You see a dream, I see a dream, and we're sacrificing our son, we're not to act on it. The game that he's playing is different. It's a different spiritual game. He's playing for a higher level, and his test is higher. So for you and I to understand this, the father and son were completely aligned. That's why when Ibrahim says to his son Ismail, Inni ara fil manami anni asbuk fandur madha tara, he says that I have seen this dream. Tell me, my son, what is your decree? And then he says, My father, Ya abatif'al ma tu'mar, satajiduni insha'allahu minas sabirin. My father, do as you have been commanded, and insha'Allah you will find me amongst the patient one. So Ibrahim and Ismail, his son, are aligned. Further than this, what was the question that was asked in the early days when Islam had first come forward? One of the questions that was asked by those people who were Ahlul Kitab, you know, some of the early Meccans, when the Quran was being revealed and the first verses were coming, they used to try to ask questions to Rasulullah that he wouldn't be able to answer. Of course, he was able to answer all of them, but they were trying to find questions that, for example, Rasulullah could not answer to belie him, to prove that he was wrong. One of the questions that they asked, for example, was, they went to the priests and the rabbis and the priests of the other Abrahamic faiths of Ahlul Kitab, and they said, give us some questions we can ask that are valid from the old scriptures, we can ask this individual. They said, look, you want to do with this, you choose what you want to do with this, but this is a question you can ask. He said, what's the question? He says that Jacob was from Palestine. How did his progeny end up in Egypt? To which ultimately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one go revealed Ahsan al-Qasas, Surah Yusuf. And he responded as to what happened. How many sons did Yaqub have? Were all of them good? Not all of Yaqub's sons necessarily were good. Not everyone was Yusuf. Not everyone was Benjamin. There were others who were perhaps jealous. They had other traits. Children of prophets. Further than this, Musa alayhi salam, the famous incident when he is to meet Khidr. When he gets to that moment where Allah tells Musa, Kalimullah, go and find someone who is more knowledgeable than you. What happens? The whole incident that you're aware of. Khidr goes on this journey, says, I just require that you have patience. So they go to one situation where there's a boat, and Khidr drills a boat, a hole into a perfectly good ship. And he says, what did you do? Musa gets upset. He said, what did you do? This is a perfectly good ship. He said, did I not tell you you will not have patience? He says, very well, I'll be patient. Don't worry. Go to the second level. Now this is one which, again, it takes a lot of time to discuss this, and there's a lot of theories on this. We don't know definitively. But again, Khidr kills a young man, as you know very well. Now how did he do this? Why did he do this? What was the basis of it? This is something that needs to be considered. He says, how did you do this? Musa gets upset at Khidr. He says, did I not tell you you will not have patience? He says, yes, I apologize. Forgive me. So then he goes to the third level. He says, look, there was this town where the people were not so hospitable to them. They needed help. The people of the town were not very helpful. In that same town where the people were not so hospitable and helpful to Khidr and Musa, Khidr fixes up a wall which has something apparently by it. He fixes up the wall, and Musa says, hold on a second, what's going on? That these people were not hospitable to us, and on top of that, you are fixing a wall that is seeming to be dilapidated. You're fixing it? How? And then Khidr says, هَذَا فِرَاقٌ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنِكَ. This is where you go your way and I go my way. Didn't I tell you to be patient? He says, yes, I apologize. He says, look, I will explain everything to you, but you have to go your way, I go my way, end of our journey. He says, as for the first situation, there were bandits, what we would call highway bandits. There was a ruler who was taking the good ships that were there from innocent people. He was taking them, usurping them. He says, I drilled this hole so that I can do this, and I can drill this hole so that the people who actually own it, the bandits, the people who are trying to steal it, they don't touch it because they're like, it's already damaged. And the people who own it can actually fix it very easily. Answer, they came to the imams, they came, for example, to our sixth imam, and they said, look, here's the situation. They said Zurara, some of our brothers in Ahl Sunnah, they say, you say Zurara is one of the good people and one of the companions of the imam, but you have statements from your own imam condemning Zurara. Zurara was a good companion. Zurara's son came to the imam. He said, Yabna Rasulillah, the people taunt me and they taunt us, and they say that your father was this and your father was that. Your own imam's statements say negative things about Zurara. The imam responded, we gave that public statement against Zurara because it was the same wisdom as Musa and Khidr drilling the hole into the ship. If it was known that Zurara had a strong connection to us, he would not be able to do the good work that he was doing. We tried to publicly distance ourselves from Zurara so that he could continue to do the good work that he was doing. He was on the right path. So sometimes things are not always as they appear. Second level, when it came to Musa and Khidr, what was the killing? Now the scholars have answered this, and some of them, I'm not saying you have to accept all of this, I'm just giving you the theories and what the scholars have said. Number one, they've said that this child, and this gets complicated especially when you draw and you combine the second and third scenario. They say that this child or this young man had been the cause of his parents becoming murtad or about to become murtad. That is, apostates and leaving the religion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaced this child with a daughter from whose womb and lineage either one prophet in some narrations or in other narrations, 70 prophets came from that line. Now here's the thing. You and I cannot take the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our own hands. We cannot do what Allah, God, and His representatives do. This is His game. For example, I don't know what's in your heart, you don't know what's in my heart, and you don't know why I do what I do. There's many dimensions to why things happen. When it comes to this, Allah, God, knows all the dimensions of the equation. And so He's able to have infinite wisdom in terms of how to act in those particular manners. So there are theories as to why the scholars have said this. Without getting too sidetracked and too derailed, we'll move to the next one. Now here's the thing. How can this young man be punished in the second scenario for something that happened to his parents? It gets even more complicated when you look at the third scenario. Why? Because in the third scenario, Khidr explains to Musa, he says, this wall that I fixed underneath it was a treasure that belonged to a father who was a righteous man. And because of his righteousness, we are protecting his orphans, his children's property. Now, what was that treasure? The scholars have a difference of opinion. Some say it was wealth from the physical perspective, like money. Others say, no, it was knowledge, books. What is knowledge? What is wealth? It depends on who you ask. It depends on the perspective of what is wealth. But further than this, is there examples of where Allah has blessed people because of the good acts of their predecessors? Yes. There are narrations that say there were many prophets that were sent to Banu Israel. And although they gave a hard time, according to narrations, to some of their prophets, God kept giving them good prophets because they had good leaders amongst them, the likes of Ibrahim, the likes of Musa, and the likes of other good leaders. Because of their goodness, their progeny was given benefit. Now, here's the thing. Is it that if the father is good or the mother is good, the child is necessarily good? As we've made clear in the instance of Adam alayhi salam, Nuh alayhi salam, Yaqub alayhi salam, not necessarily. If the father and the mother do good, there can be potentiality of good in the children, but not necessary. The decision is ultimately on the child to follow through in the action. Now the question comes, what is our responsibility in this matter? Our responsibility is to do whatever we can in our capacity and our ability to make sure we give the right tarbiyah to our children so that you and I can ultimately sleep at night. Whether they ultimately are good or not is their decision and the will perhaps of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if we do our job, at least we can say we did what was in our ability. If you do everything that you're supposed to do, that is a necessary condition. But it's not sufficient necessarily. The will of Allah is what is a part of the equation. I'll give you an example. If you spend your whole life dieting and exercising and eating healthy, and for example, you exercise every day, you do cardiovascular exercise, you do resistance training, you lift weights, and you eat the healthiest of food. And then after 10 years, 15 years, you get a disease, an illness. Can you say that your exercise and diet was not a good decision? Of course not. That was a good decision, but it ended up happening something, but perhaps maybe if you didn't do that, you'd have the illness much earlier, for example. And sometimes there's genetics and there's the will of God. So what I'm saying is you and I need to do whatever's in our ability, and the rest is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now coming to the children very quickly, what is it that we can do? You know, the verse that I recited, there's something phenomenal about the Quran when you start developing this relationship. وَلَئِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ Very famous part of a verse. وَلَئِن كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَزَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ Very famous verse that you, I hope, have heard. Where that if you, for example, if you are grateful, وَلَئِن شَكَرْتُمْ We will increase it. Now the verse doesn't tell you what you'll increase, what will be increased. Increase could be in barakah, increase could be in wealth, increase could be in knowledge, increase. There's a principle that the Quran has outlined. When you are grateful, Allah will increase it. And when you are not, when you do kufran in ni'mat, there's shukran in ni'mat, that is being grateful for a blessing, and there is kufran in ni'mat, that is to be not being appreciative and grateful for a gift that Allah has given you. When you are ungrateful, Allah says, then you will have a painful chastisement, a severe chastisement, I should say. So why is this beneficial? One thing that you need to understand is, we need to take the teachings from the Ahlul Bayt, from the Quran, and we need to make sure we are curbing this with the modern science of what's coming out in terms of how to raise children. I'll give you an example, and I've mentioned this numerous times. We have in numerous traditions that knowledge, ilm, hikmah, wisdom, is the lost property of a mu'min, lost property of a believer. You should get it from wherever you can. In fact, in other traditions it says, it is the lost camel, get it from wherever you can. Now provided it's within the framework of the Quran, it's within the framework of the Ahadith, it's within the framework of Islam, and it's not transgressing the bounds. It's not saying, for example, that a child, when it's born, or the fetus initially, is just a ball of chemicals, and you can abort it and get rid of it. This is not necessarily what we're trying to say. What we're saying is that if something makes logical sense, something is aligned with the Quran and does not transgress the Quran's teachings, and it does not transgress the principles that are there. For example, if you save one human being, if you save all of humanity, a Quranic precept and Quranic principle, if it's not violating that, then it's something you should take on board. Allow me to explain. It's very important to have sincere, honest conversations with your children. There's a philosopher by the name of Montesquieu. He lived a few hundred years ago. He was a French philosopher. And he said something interesting, which I want to invite you to consider. He said a man or a child, a human being, has three educators, three people who teach. He says number one is the parents, the first teachers, who teach the child, number one. Number two is the schoolmaster. The schoolmaster is the one who teaches the second teacher of the child, the teacher, the principal, things of this nature, school. And the third, Montesquieu says, is the world. And when the child comes to the world, or the young man or the young woman comes to the world, they realize that what the world teaches them contradicts what the first two teachers taught. It contradicts what the parents taught, and it contradicts what the school taught. Why? Because the world teaches you how things are, whereas your parents and the teachers teach you how things should be. You should be good, you should be fair, you should be nice, you should be this, you should be that. But when you get to the real world, you find out things are not always fair. Isn't that what Bill Gates said in his commencement speech? The world is not fair. When you get to the real world, you find that everyone's not always honest. When you get to the real world, you find that people are not always just. Does that mean as a parent I should not tell my children to be honest, fair, and just? No, no, no. It means you should definitely tell them. But you also simultaneously explain to them that unfortunately people are not always acting the right way, and you need to be aware of that. Have you heard that nice guys finish last slogan? You should be a nice guy, you should be a nice girl, you should be a nice person, but at the same time that does not mean you should be naive. This is also part of Islamic teachings. A mu'min is never naive. That's why Imam Ali said that I can beat Muawiyah at his own game, but my principles do not allow me to bend the rules like Muawiyah. Imam Ali knew exactly what Muawiyah was doing. But at the same time, he said, look, I can't do this because I cannot kill innocent people. I cannot bribe people. I cannot do injustice. So it's very important to have a balance. Number one, what should you teach your children? I feel obligated, because this is some advice that may help you and your children down the line. In my conversations and my travels across the wherever Allah has been able to take us through the zikr of the Ahlul Bayt, I've tried to ask some of the most successful people in our community what are the things that they teach their children, what are the things that they try to teach their families, and what are the most important. These are people who are close to billionaires, these are people who are some of the most educated, and people, sometimes I've stayed at their house, sometimes I've spent time with them, and I ask them, you know, if you could give one suggestion or advice, what would you give? And some themes that have come about. The first three are very important. Now the thing is, I want you to look at this and listen to these first three with new eyes and new ears, because they will help in the rest of the four, seven things. Number one, the first element is never forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God Almighty. Because when you know that Allah has your back, when you know that God has your back, you're not afraid of anything. This is why Imam al-Sadiq says that a mu'min, a believer, is one who fears nothing except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When this truly seeps in your heart and mind, you become the most powerful person in the world. But it doesn't seep into everyone's heart. The first principle, never forget Allah has your back if you fight for His cause, if you work for His cause, number one. That is good for humanity, good for people, good for the world, serving humanity. Number one, never forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, never forget the Qur'an al-Majid wal-Furqan al-Hamid. It will give you guidance in the most difficult times. Some of the scholars say that you will not find a book that is, if you develop a relationship with the Quran, you will find it to be more paternal than your father and more maternal than your mother in terms of how much it cares for you. You will begin, because it's a living book, it speaks to you. Third thing, never forget the Ahlul Bayt. They are the practical implementers of God's law on earth. Once you have these three, they will help you in the rest, because the rest are not easy. Number four, always do difficult things, do not do easy things. Why? Because if you do easy things, everyone tries to find the path of least resistance. Everyone tries to do the easiest thing in life. When you do the hard thing, the difficult thing, you will find there is little competition. There's not many people who are vying for what you're vying for. So teach your children, don't always go for the path of least resistance. Go perhaps for the most difficult thing, and you will find that oftentimes that you will be in a better position, because the people, it's not a race to the bottom, as they say. That's number four. Number five, conquer fear. This is one of the things that's the most easy to say, most difficult to implement. If there's one trait to teach your children, it is to conquer fear. Fear is what holds people back. Fear is what keeps people grounded. Fear is what keeps people back. For example, what did Iqbal say? Iqbal, the poet Iqbal, when he said about the falcon, he said the winds come and hit the falcon, not to demoralize it, but to encourage it to fly higher, to go to a higher altitude. Similarly, to teach your children that fear of embarrassment, fear of failure, fear of this, fear of that, conquer it and realize it is a construct of the mind. It is a construct that if you understand it and know that Allah, the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt are in your back and supporting you, you can do anything. Conquer fear. Teach your children to conquer fear. The fifth element of the equation. Number six, be innovative. Think outside the box. Don't always try to take the solutions that everyone is thinking about. Think about things that are different. That's also not easy. It takes some practice. And the final is always be learning, always consistently be learning. There's many examples of this, but I'll give you a very quick narrative about this. There was two people, I heard this and I read this recently, so I wanted to share this. Two people who used to come every single day to chop down trees. You know, chopping down trees, lumber, you know, these individuals. They would always come at the same time of the day. They would come in the morning and they would leave at the same time at night. But one of them every single day would go home and take a 1 hour break and come back. And the one who used to come and take a 1 hour break and come back, like a lunch break and come back, he always used to end the day with two times more chopped wood than the other person. The one who's taking a break is ending up with more wood cut by the end of the day. So one day, the one who's spending day and night sweating and he's not even taking a break, he asks his buddy, he asks his friend, he said, why is it that every single day I come at the same time as you and I leave at the same time as you and I don't even take a break? You take a break in the day and you end up with two times more wood cut than I do. So what do you do on this break? What is it that, what's your secret? He said, you really want to know what's my secret, why I end up with more wood? He said, what is it? He says, every day I take a 1 hour break to go back home and sharpen my saw. And then I come back. And when I sharpen my saw and I come back, I'm able to cut two times more wood. That reading, that learning, that knowledge is the sharpening of the saw. When you're constantly learning, you're able to get miles ahead of the others. I was telling some of the big speakers from the past, I was telling some of our elders, they used to read extensively, but do you know what they used to do? Some of them, some of the elite ones, the best speakers in history, they would invite a professor over to their house for tea or dinner. Why? Their children say. They say, why? Because they said when we would invite a professor or an expert who spent 30 years of their life in one domain, in a 1 hour or 2 hours, you're able to get that information which you never thought possible in just a condensed environment. This is one of the benefits of this. By the way, you may think your children are not able to understand. Do you know, don't please, I request you, do not think that your children are not able. They may be much more able than you imagine. I'll give you an example. The school systems are not always the same everywhere. I hope you know this, right? County by county it differs, state by state it differs, country by country it differs. You'll find people in Singapore and other places in Scandinavian countries, they excel in certain things. Whereas in America, we may have more creativity, which is really nice. But at the same time, there are other things that we may learn from. For example, in certain Scandinavian countries, they teach computer science logic from third grade. Now you may say, how is it possible? But it's possible. I remember I had a physics TA when I was studying physics in undergrad, and her mother was a professor of physics, and she said she taught her calculus, you know, algebra, calculus, one of the subjects, at the age of 10. I said, we were shocked. How did you learn calculus at 10? She said, I didn't have a reference point. Now, you think that calculus is very difficult, so you would never teach it to your 10-year-old. But who told you it's difficult? You may have talked to them and realized that they may be able to grasp the concept even better than you. So it's very important to teach your child these things. The second, there was a lot to say, I won't take much of your time, we're gonna wrap it up right here. But always teach your child to be optimistic. There's a lot of research that shows that optimistic children become happier, healthier, wealthier, and they perform better on every metric. And what's really beautiful about this is you can actually teach this. That is, if you read the works of Dr. Martin Seligman at University of Pennsylvania, Learned Optimism and How to Raise an Optimistic Child, it's tremendously beneficial. Why? Because when we say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, when we praise Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala in our salah, in our ibadah, how do we teach our children why we praise Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala? Does Allah need our praise? One other tip that I'm giving you here in the final advice is when you praise, one of the things is called special compliments. This is something that modern science at Yale and others have found, that if you want your child to behave in a particular manner, number one, give them positive feedback. So if they do something good, you first have a tonality of excitement. Number two, you tell them exactly what you're praising them for. Oh my gosh, you cleaned up this space, you cleaned up your toys. And then the third thing is you physically touch them, you give them a hug. Non-verbal communication. All three of those things need to be here. But also you need to make sure what you don't do. What you don't do is you do these three elements. Excitement, you tell them you cleaned up your toys, and then you hug them, and you say, why don't you always do this? That's like spilling milk over all of the hard work. Don't criticize. Affection. Research has shown that the love in the first 2 years of a child, children who are neglected and not shown love, their physical brains are smaller than those children who are exposed to love in the first 2 years of life. That love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we're told that 99 parts are for Allah, one part is for the mother, that love we need to teach our children. That's how you give the rise to the likes of Aliun al-Akbar, the likes of Al-Qasim. That Aliun al-Akbar, he says when he's asked about this on the way to Karbala, and he has a conversation with his father, he says, my father, are we not on the right path? Are we not on haq? He said, yes, we are, my son. Indeed we are. He says, then what difference does it make if death falls on us or we fall on death? Does science know, does the world know what that truly means? Allah knows what that means. Maybe one day we'll find out the depth of what Ali al-Akbar was saying. Or Qasim, when Imam al-Husayn asks his nephew, he says, my nephew Qasim, how do you find death? He says, my uncle ahla min al-asal, sweeter than honey. Only the son of Hasan al-Mujtaba can say this. Who can say this line? At that age, 13 years old? The children of Muslim, Tiflani Muslim, as you know, Muslim's wife was the sister of Abbas ibn Amir al-Mu'minin, Hazrat Abbas. That is, the children of Muslim were the nephews of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. They were the grandchildren of Umm al-Baneen. This was the line of Amir al-Mu'minin from both sides, the line of Abu Talib. If any one person has given more blood in the history of Karbala, it is Abu Talib. The lines all go back to Abu Talib. This individual, his family, the narrations say that these two children, the Tiflani Muslim, they were imprisoned and captured. There's two riwayat, I will share one riwayah with you. These children were imprisoned, and finally, there was one prison guard who was from the followers of the Ahlul Bayt. Sometimes you didn't know who was the one in the prison until you had a conversation, you understood who was this individual, who was this personality. This individual finally understood that this was from the Ahlul Bayt. This individual is from the line of the Ahlul Bayt. At that point in time, the arrangement was made, and these children escaped. Muhammad and Ibrahim, Tiflani Muslim, they escaped. When they escaped from the prison and the dungeon, they went on a journey, and they would travel in the day and they would rest in the night. At this point in time, there was a bounty put on their head. They were trying to get these two children. They were trying to kill them off. There is a narration that a man who was a shaqi, a person who was hard-hearted, he finds them, and he finds them by the river. When he finds these two individuals, Muhammad and Ibrahim, by the river, he understands and discovers that these are the children of Muslim ibn Aqil. These are Tiflani Muslim. At that point in time, he takes these two children and he's about to butcher them and he's about to finish them. At that point in time, he says, do you have any final wish? These two boys, these two brothers, they look towards him and he says, we have one request. We request that you allow us to pray two units of prayers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These two brothers, they pray their units of prayer towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their last prayer, and then they raise their small hands, their young hands towards the heavens, and they say, Ya Ahkam al Hakimeen. They say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh, the best of deciders, oh, the best of judges, decide between us and decide between this individual. Now, the decision was made in the Akhirah, but at that point in time, this individual, he wanted to behead one of the children, and then he wanted to behead the other, one after the other, because he was going to take the heads, he was going to get a prize for the bounty of killing these two young ones. At that point, point in time, he takes one of the brothers and he's about to behead that child. And at that moment, the other brother, it seems, he tries to say, as if he is trying to get in the way and he is trying to stop, and he's saying, no, take me first. And the other brother is saying, no, it is as if he's saying, take me first. These are the children from the Ahlul Bayt. These are the children of Ali Muhammad, the poet. He captures this moment. He says, ek hashr bapa ho gaya khanjar ke tale par, ek hashr bapa ho gaya khanjar ke tale par, bhai ne gala rakh diya, bhai azadaro khanjar chala tiflane muslim unke jism darya mein dal diye gaye. Azadaro, ye do bhai the. Zojai Muslim ibn Aqil, ek maa wahan thi, Zainab ulia maqam, ye Ali Muhammad. Ala la'natullahi ala al-qawm al-zalimin, wa say'alamu al-lazina zalamu ayyaman qalibin qalibun inna lillah, wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Matam ya Hussein, ya Hussein, ya Hussein, ya Hussein.
Ya Rab, har ek ko ye saadat naseeb ho, karbo bala ki sab ko ziyarat naseeb ho. Chalo Karbala chale, Eish-e-ke-azadar. Chalo Karbala chale, Eish-e-ke-azadar. Chalo Karbala chale, ye dil hai bekarar, ye dil hai bekarar. Chalo Karbala chale, Eish-e-ke-azadar. Chalo Karbala chale, Eish-e-ke-azadar. Chalo Karbala chale, Abbas namdar ke roze pe jayenge. Ja kar waha sakina ka noha sunayenge. Dekhenge wo dayar, dekhenge wo dayar. Chalo Karbala chale, Eish-e-ke-azadar. Chalo Karbala chale, Eish-e-ke-azadar. Chalo Karbala chale, ghar apne aansuon se karenge wo hum zameen. Kha kar sina gira tha jahan ak bare hazin, sab honge ashk bar, sab honge ashk bar. Chalo Karbala chale, Eish-e-ke-azadar. Chalo Karbala chale, Eish-e-ke-azadar. Chalo Karbala chale, Ashk-e-gham-e-Husain milaye Furat mein. نو ہے کہ سب عریض بہائے فرات میں موجوں کو دے قرار موجوں کو دے قرار چلو کربلا چلے اے شہ کے عزادار چلو کربلا چلے اے شہ کے عزادار چلو کربلا چلے پھر پابا رہ نہ جائیں گے بازار شام میں زینب گئی تھی جس طرح دربار عام میں دل کی ہے یہ پکار دل کی ہے یہ پکار چلو کربلا چلے اے شہ کے عزادار چلو کربلا چلے اے شہ کے عزادار چلو کربلا چلے دشت بلا میں بانو اے دلگیر کی فغاں ابھی سنائی دیتی ہے اصغر کی ہچکیاں آہوں کے حسار آہوں کے حسار چلو کربلا چلے اے شہ کے عزادار چلو کربلا چلے اے شہ کے عزادار چلو کربلا چلے یہ دل ہے بے قرار یہ دل ہے بے قرار چلو کربلا چلے اے شہ کے عزادار چلو کربلا چلے اے شہ کے عزادار چلو کربلا چلے
سورۃ مبارک الفاتحہ
بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم اللہم صلی علی محمد و آل محمد السلام علیک یا رسول اللہ السلام علیک یا امیر المؤمنین السلام علیک یا فاطمۃ الزہرا سیدتی نساء العالمین السلام علیک یا خدیجۃ الکبریٰ السلام علیک یا حسن المجتبیٰ السلام علیک یا وارث آدم صفوة اللہ السلام علیک یا وارث نوح نبی اللہ السلام علیک یا وارث ابراہیم خلیل اللہ السلام علیک یا وارث موسیٰ کلیم اللہ السلام علیک یا وارث عیسیٰ روح اللہ السلام علیک یا وارث محمد حبیب اللہ السلام علیک یا وارث امیر المؤمنین علیہ السلام ولی اللہ السلام علیک یا ابن محمد المصطفی السلام علیک یا ابن علی المرتضی السلام علیک یا ابن فاطمۃ الزہرا السلام علیک یا ابن خدیجۃ الکبریٰ السلام علیک یا ثار اللہ وابن ثاره والوتر الموتور اشہد انک قد اقمت الصلاۃ واتیت الزکاۃ وأمرت بالمعروف ونهيت عن المنكر وأطعت الله ورسوله حتى أتاك اليقين فلعن الله أمة قتلتك ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك ولعن الله أمة استهلت منك المحارم يا مولاه يا أبا عبد الله أشهد أنك كنت نورا في الأصلاب الشامخة والأرحام المطهرة لم تنجسك الجاهلية بأنجاسها ولم تلبسك من مدلهمات ثيابها وأشهد أنك من دعائم الدين وأركان المؤمنين وأشهد أنك الإمام البر التقي الرزي الزكي الهادي المهدي وأشهد أن الأئمة من ولدك كلمة التقوى وأعلام الهدى والعروة الوثقى والحجة على أهل الدنيا وأشهد الله وملائكته وأنبياءه ورسله أني بكم مؤمن وبيا بكم موقن بشرعي ديني وخواتيمي عملي وقلبي لقلبكم سلم وأمري لأمركم متبع صلوات الله عليكم وعلى أرواحكم وعلى أجسادكم وعلى أجسامكم وعلى شاهدكم وعلى غائبكم وعلى ظاهركم وعلى باطنكم السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله السلام عليك يا ابن نبي الله السلام عليك يا ابن أمير المؤمنين السلام عليك يا ابن الحسين الشهيد السلام عليك أيها الشهيد وابن الشهيد السلام عليك أيها المظلوم وابن المظلوم لعن الله أمة قتلتك ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك ولعن الله أمة سمعت بذلك فرضيت به السلام عليكم يا أولياء الله وأحباءه السلام عليكم يا أصفياء الله وأوداءه السلام عليكم يا أنصار دين الله السلام عليكم يا أنصار رسول الله السلام عليكم يا أنصار أمير المؤمنين السلام عليكم يا أنصار فاطمة سيدتي نساء العالمين السلام عليكم يا أنصار أبي محمد الحسن بن علي الولي الزكي الناصح السلام عليكم يا أنصار أبي عبد الله بأبي أنتم وأمي طبتم وطابت العرض التي فيها دفنتم وفوزتم فوزا عظيما فيا ليتني كنت معكم فأفوز معكم السلام عليك يا أبا الفضل العباس ابن أمير المؤمنين السلام عليك يا ابن سيد الوصيين السلام عليك يا ابن أول القوم إسلاما وأقدمهم إيمانا وأقومهم بدين الله وعهوتهم على الإسلام أشهد لقد نصحت لله ولرسوله ولأخيك فنيم الأخ المواسي فلعن الله أمة قتلتك ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك ولعن الله أمة استهلت منك المحارم وانتهكت حرمة الإسلام ونعم الصابر المجاهد المهام الناصر ولا خد دافي عن أخيه المجيب إلى طاعة ربي الراغب فيما زهد فيه غيره من الثواب الجزيل والثناء الجميل والحقك الله بدرجة آبائك في جنات النعيم اللهم إني تعرضت لزيارة أوليائك رغبة في ثوابك ورجاء لمغفرتك وجزيل إحسانك فأسألك أن تصلي على محمد وآله الطاهرين وأن تجعل رزقي بهم دارا وعيشي بهم قارا وزيارتي بهم مقبولة وحياتي بهم طيبة وأدرجني إدراج المكرمين واجعلني ممن ينقلب من زيارة مشاهد أحبائك مفلحان منجهان قد استوجبت غفران الذنوب وستر العيوب وكشف الكروب إنك أهل التقوى وأهل المغفرة السلام عليك يا إمة المسلمين من ذرية الحسين علي بن الحسين زين العابدين ومحمد بن علي الباقر وجعفر بن محمد الصادق وموسى بن جعفر القادم وعلي بن موسى الرضا ومحمد بن علي التقي وعلي بن محمد النقي والحسن بن علي العسكري السلام عليك يا حجة الله يا ابن الحسن يا صاحب العصر والزمان السلام عليك يا خليفة الرحمن السلام عليك يا شريك القرآن السلام عليك يا كعبة الإيمان السلام عليك يا إمام الإنس والجان أجر الله فرجك وسهل الله تعالى مخرجك وظهورك ورحمة الله وبركاته
اللهم كل وليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسنقه أرجك توا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين